right, everybody, it is a pleasure to start the first masterclass of the Global University Film Awards. My name is Mike Robinson. I'm on the faculty at the Academy of Film, where I teach animation and other things, and it's a pleasure to introduce our speaker today. Today's topic is about story, but this man has an incredible life story. He started his animation career 30 years ago working on a film called Roger Rabbit. Have people heard of it? Who Killed Roger Rabbit? I have a feeling we're in a room full of animators. What a fantastic film to start on. He then moved to Disney, where he worked on some of the biggest features of its roster. The Little Mermaid, Beauty and the Beast, Lion King. Everybody heard of these? I'm sure you have. Great films. He also was the president of Warner Brothers Feature Animation. He worked on Space Jam and The Iron Giant, which was the directorial debut of Brad Bird, who went on to direct The Incredibles and other amazing films. He's produced films for DreamWorks, as I've said, Exodus Group, and many, many more. In addition to his work in Hollywood, he's worked all over the world, and he's also working in China. And without further ado, let's hear it for our guest, Max Howard.
Made you look.
Good morning. Thank you so much for that lovely introduction. And thank you so much for your applause for that film, because there's not one frame of my personal work in those films, but they are the films that I worked on. So you were applauding the literally hundreds, probably thousands of people who contributed to these movies, because it's animation. All art for me is in cinema is a collective art form, but I think no more so than in animation. It truly is the coming together of artists, and I was fortunate enough to work on those movies. So what better way for me to start my talk this morning than to show you some of the films I've worked on. That's just a blessing for me and a lovely way of introducing myself. So that's my film. So today, let me back up a little bit. Where does it all begin? Well, for me, it began with this. I was actually a child actor. My dad was an actor. I go back many generations, but I started off running around movie sets. I worked on some films as a little kid. I was never famous, but it gave me it was lucky that I survived without a proper education, but I have an education in the movies, being in movie studios, and so that's how I started. So, I was a child actor, a theater stage manager, a theater director and producer, and really, you know, my love My original love was the theatre. I love live performances. I like this. I have all of you in front of me, and we're here together, and there's an energy that's created. And as long as I do keep my energy levels up, you'll keep your energy levels up, and we may have a good time. But I love that interaction, which you lose somewhat in the movies. You don't have that feedback. But, you know, I had a career in the theatre, and, you know, I was doing pretty well. I was producing, directing in London. Oh, I have a British accent, for those of you who can hear that, right? I'm not actually British anymore. I'm actually an American. I'm not sure I want to be an American at the moment, but that's another whole situation we can have as a political discussion, but I'm surviving. But yeah, I've lived in America since 1988, and the reason I've been in America since that time is because I was working in the theater, and I got to work on a film called Who Framed Roger Rabbit, and I'll come back to that in a moment. But it was a career change for me. I managed the studio in London where the film was made. Disney was in the middle of a resurgence of its animation division, and I was asked to go to America after Roger Rabbit, and it was the right time in my personal life, and so off I went to the States. So it was a complete change, and that's why my credits suddenly changed. Suddenly I'm at Disney, and then I'm at Warner Brothers, DreamWorks, and my own company, Melwood Pictures. I have a consulting group. That's my little logo up there. And fortunately, for the last, many years, 5-6 years, I have been a master at Didal. And I'm here today because of the association between the university and Didal. And this has been wonderful for me. It's given me an education in China. And for the last 3 years, I've actually had an apartment in Shanghai, spending 3 months of every year in Shanghai. And there's nothing like it. I chose an apartment because I didn't want the hotel life. I want to go shopping and just try and really scratch the surface. I'm in that position now. The more I know about China, the less I understand, but that's okay. At least I know that. That's been a fantastic experience. That's my background. Because of my British heritage and my life in America, I'm fortunate enough to be one of those very few people who get to vote for the best movies, live action and animation, in both the British Academy Awards, BAFTA, and the Oscars. So I get to do both of those. So that's a great honor for me, of course, to be part of those two organizations. So that's me. So it's time to take my jacket off because we want to keep this. He says not holding the microphone, always helpful. This is what I've been doing in China, actually, as well as teaching at many schools, doing talks like this on various, I'll talk about producing films, story and pitching is what we're going to talk about today, but many aspects of the entertainment industry. But this is what I've been doing in China. I've been particularly interested in classic Chinese stories. I have a theory about the Silk Road, the original Silk Road. It's quite interesting. You know, you can come to China and you can find Cinderella-style stories. You can look at the great Chinese classic Two Butterflies. You can see influences there, or influences perhaps to Shakespeare, to Romeo and Juliet. There's quite many of these stories cross over. They're the same, and so I have this imagination that the Silk Road, of course, it was a road for taking goods east to west, west to east. It took culture. It took stories as well. You travel all day. You stop at night. You cook food. You sit around and you tell stories because, of course, a lot of the earliest forms of entertainment were storytellers. And so you can see how these stories went all the way that way and then perhaps came all the way back again. So I've loved working in developing Chinese stories. I was fortunate. The last movie I worked on at Disney was Mulan, Fa Mulan. I didn't realize at the time what an important story that was within Chinese culture. And we were talking mid-90s. We did send our directors and producers over here to do as we did as much as we can. I know the criticism from my members of my Chinese audience here, which is the shape of her face, her eyes are not right. I know that. And there's a second criticism actually of Mulan. The second criticism is why didn't we make it? And maybe that's at the heart of what we want to talk about today: is why didn't you make it? Well, there's an art to story structure. It's not about formulas. Well, I suppose it is about formulas, not about formulaic structures. But it's how to tell a story, how to bring an audience in, give them 90 minutes, 2 hours of entertainment, how to take them on a journey. And that's what's so important, and that's the heart of what we're going to talk about today. So anyway, that's my life in China. So yeah, let's just go back to Roger Rabbit briefly. It was life-changing for me. I had managed a revival of a very important John Osborne play called The Entertainer. I've got some Brits in the audience, right? I'm looking at some people as though they should be British, and they're looking at me going, no, I'm not British. So there's a gentleman there with glasses. He's going, no. Anyway, but it's a very famous, very important play. It was a disaster. The press came to see the play, didn't like it. The public didn't buy tickets, and I was out of work. And I was out of work when the phone went. And my phone went, and it was somebody I knew who'd gone to work for Disney. They were now coming to London to set up the making of a film called Who Framed Roger Rabbit around a wonderful animation director called Richard Williams. And I worked for 2 years on this film, had a most amazing, life-changing time. But I often think back to that moment. You know, you have moments in your life where things change so dramatically. I can't tell you the disappointment when this very important play was a failure at the box office. But that failure actually changed my entire career, because had that play not failed, I wouldn't be here today. I wouldn't have worked on any of these films. Disney would have called me and I would have said, oh, thank you for thinking of me, but hey, I'm working. I'm so sorry. So it was a good lesson for me in life. You know, there's lots of sayings, you know, when a door is closed or a window is closed, the door is opened. And that can be. And as you go through your careers of potential disappointments, just remember it's because something else is going to happen, and you can reflect back as I have done. But this was so pivotal to me. And I worked on this wonderful film. And I put up these slides because I love technology. And I love what technology can do for us. But at the heart of it is great stories and great acting. And Roger Rabbit was a beautiful combination of technology, which, of course, the combination of combining an optical composite of live action and animation together. But at the heart of it, everyone had to be believers. And the greatest believer, the greatest bit of technology in Roger Rabbit for me is actually the performance of an actor called Bob Hoskins, who played Eddie Valiant. This guy, dear Roger's not there when the director said action. He ain't there. He imagined he was looking at something that wasn't there. Absolutely brilliant. I've got a little experiment I want to do with you. Would you all hold up your hand? Doesn't matter which one it is, your right or left hand. I want you to focus on the palm of your hand. And I'm going to say action in a minute. And the idea, what we want to do, see if you can focus, keep your focus on your hand or where your hand was when your hand isn't there anymore. Something quite interesting happens, but it's what he had to do, what Bob Hoskins had to do when the director said action. So I'm going to go 1, 2, 3, action, all right? So one, so focus on your palm of your hand. Find that little crease in the palm of your hand. It's you two. It's really you two. Look at your hand. Focus on it. Okay, 1, 2, 3, action. Take your hand away. What happens to your eyes? Yeah, you went cross-eyed. If you didn't go cross-eyed, it's because you didn't do what you were supposed to do. Because the idea is that if you look at something, our eyes tend to focus on whatever we see. So if we don't see something, then we're not focused. So what Bob Hoskins was able to do was make you believe that he was seeing Roger. It's a wonderful, wonderful performance. It's what made the film work, and then everything else works. Anyway, that's my little Roger story. But it was a wonderful film to work on because it was financially successful, which is what I learned in America. Success is always judged by how much money something takes, which is something I've come to terms with and learned to understand. But Roger was also a critical success, and they're rare when you can combine those two things together. So that's Roger Rabbit. Okay, so what does a producer do? Because I'm a producer. I'm a sort of a studio executive producer. I bring teams together. And of course, I have to find the stories to tell and things to make. But as we want to talk about pitching today, I also want to explain what a producer does. I think it's the hardest title in entertainment to explain. Because if I say I'm a director or a writer, you go, okay, I get that. But as soon as you say the word producer, it can be so many things. It can be just the finance guy. It can be the creative producer. I put myself more in the creative producer. So this is what a producer does. This is what I think a producer does. This is what I try and do. Oh, yeah, I hang out with animated characters. live-action producers hang out with all the movie stars. I hang out with animated characters. So that's Jessica. Somebody, a friend of mine, did that for me. Okay, so this is what I think you should do. You have an amount of money, and you have a story, a script. You've got to balance the two. You've got to balance the film's creative vision with the resources. The resources, it's people, it's time, it's all the things you have. Now, when you do your student films or anything you do, this, you have that same, we can call it a conundrum. You have to put your assignment in by a certain time. You have to plan how you're going to spend your resources. Your resources is your own time. And that's what I have to do on a very grand scale. But I do it with this in my mind, which is there is never enough time and there's never enough money. I've worked on films, produced films for, you know, $100 million, and I've done them real low-budget movies. I've never had enough of these. I could always add more time, and I could always have more money. Nobody ever says, you know, oh, I've got money left. The trick to this is celebrating that, but it's celebrating what you do have. It's how you use the time. It's how you spend the money. And particularly with animation, which these films take so long, making a film consistent from beginning to end, money shots, planning your movie. What's the best way to make the movie? What's the best way to put the visual effects work in? Talk to all the department heads. What's the best way? What about marketing the movie? How are we going to do a trailer? All the things you want to do, you figure out, and you must bring everybody with you, including the director. The director must be on board. You have an amount of money to spend. How are we going to spend it? How do we get the most out of what we have? But if you spend the entire time just worrying about what you don't have, it's negative and it doesn't really help you. It's important, you know, when you do budget and schedule and put together a movie, that you're realistic with your movie. It's no good saying I can do a low budget movie, but you don't have a low budget film. But be realistic, celebrate what you do have. So there's my definition of what I try and do as a producer. But today, creating an effective story and how to pitch it, that's what we're going to try and cover. Let's start as we should do. We're going to start with the story. So there's no matter where you are in the world, doesn't matter what culture you are, or you're making movies, if you want to create a great movie, I'm going to give you three things that you have to do. And number one just happens to be story. And funnily enough, number two happens to be story. And number three happens to be story. I know it's a little bit of a cliche. Sometimes cliches are worth remembering because it's often so easy to get ahead of oneself. But if you can get this piece right, you can deliver a movie. But I've worked on movies where we've written the story as we were going, and I've been incredibly successful at doing that. Unfortunately, it's incredibly expensive to do that. And so it flies in the face. You know, you can do it. Pixar does it all the time. And it's not a bad sandbox, but it's a $200 million sandbox. It's an evolutionary process. It's a fantastic process. But really, and it's because of my theater background, really, I love the written word. I love a script. I think it's the greatest place to start with that story. If you get the story right and you get a script right, then, of course, you can budget it. You can accurately schedule it, and then everybody knows what they're doing. These words, as all my words, are easy to say and hard to do, but that's at the heart of it. But there are really three things. You need this great story, right? You've got to have a believable world. And for me, because animation can invent worlds, the rules of those worlds, the audience needs to understand. So if fish are talking, we're going to talk about Finding Nemo in a minute. If fish are talking, you're living under the sea, I need to understand the rules of the world, of what they're in. So this believable world, doesn't matter, you can go anywhere, but make it believable. Believable means I can understand it. Oh, I've just crashed. That's interesting. Excuse me one moment while I fire up my, see what happened. Am I back? So a believable world and engaging characters. I mean, characters you want to spend time with. And I don't just mean heroes. I mean villains. In fact, villains have a great role to play. Often we depict a villainous character as bad and they jump up and down and I want to rule the world. Villains are really, really interesting when they're complex and they're intelligent. Never underestimate them. If the smarter they are, the cleverer they are, the more far-reaching they are, the more interesting they are, the more the audience care about them being defeated. Now, obviously, I'm talking there about a sort of hero's journey story, and I'll look at three different types of story structures in a moment, and we'll focus on one of them. But they're the three things you really need to seek that you've got. Don't have anything in a story that's superfluous to it. Remember that all the characters in the story, they are there, particularly all the supporting characters are there to support the journey of the principal characters. They're not there just for their own sake. They're part of the manipulation of the audience. And manipulation I use in a very positive way. You as a director, you're taking the audience on a journey and you need all these tools and these supporting characters do that. Sometimes supporting characters can run away with the movie because they're great to write for, they're great fun, and somehow we care more about those characters than we do about the principal characters. They're there to serve the main goal. So they're the three ingredients. Okay, that's the three R's. So I was just talking then very clearly about the hero's journey, but these are the three structures that I think we tend to use in animation. For me, there's a fourth structure, which is an ensemble movie, Pulp Fiction or Crash or those types. That's what I would call an ensemble movie. They have various different plot lines that interweave. I think it's I love that type of movie. We tend not to use them in animation. No reason why they shouldn't be used. No reason why we shouldn't always challenge story structure and everything else. And I'll come to that later. But we got Hero's Journey, Buddy Movie, and Love Story. Ironically, there's the story structures of a buddy movie and a love story are very, very similar. You get two opposites, they get together, they're pulled apart, and they get together again. That's a sort of buddy movie structure. They have to have a conflict. I'm going to talk about one particular movie in a moment. Nothing wrong with these formulas, by the way. Don't jump to thinking, I won't do that because this is a... No, these are just underlying structures. You conflict the characters and you conflict the audience and you make changes all the time. But essentially, that's what you do. A hero's journey goes sort of in one direction with setbacks. And a buddy movie just wants lots of opposites. Opposites attract. And they go through a terrible time and then they get back together again. But I often think it's like a concertina. I'm sorry, I keep moving the microphone. But it's like a concertina, the musical instrument of playing that. You continually bring them together and pull them apart again. So there are three structures that we should always look at. I should also say that you can mix these structures up. You can have a buddy movie that also has a love story element. But one of it is should be the more senior of the structures. But you can have love stories within buddy movies, absolutely. Or hero's journeys with love stories, absolutely. So hero's journey, a classic. The Lion King is a classic hero's journey. Now, this is one which has a love story associated with it. There's Nala, but it's a secondary plot line. It's secondary. This is a hero. This is a coming-of-age story where you see a character take responsibility and learn. And you can look at these films, you could look at Karate Kid or, so many stories or Star Wars, which I'll talk about endlessly, which is there's a middle section where you see a character learning something. And that's the sort of middle of Act Two. You see them ill-equipped, they become equipped, and they journey on to success and putting the world to rights. Lots of examples of that. So Hero's Journey, the buddy movie, I think the greatest buddy movie in animation is Toy Story. I had nothing to do with it. It's so beautiful. It's what you could do in animation. You can't really do this with humans. What we have in animation is you have Woody, who's organic, and he's made of fabric, and he's been so hand-stitched together. And you have a machine-molded piece of plastic. So not only do you have different personalities, but you have, they're actually created out of different things. So it takes these ideas and elevates them in something that's much harder to do in live action. You really take advantage of that. So you think about Toy Story. They're opposites. They come together. They get pulled apart. But ultimately, they learn to accept who each other are. And it's a very important piece of a buddy structure. And then lastly, the love story. Beauty and the Beast is a classic love story. Learning to judge something not by their look. Great, it's a lovely message anyway. It teaches us all. And as we sit here today, you know, with people from all over the world have come to this event with different backgrounds, different. But underneath all of that, we have much more in common than we think we do. The basic ambitions and loves and what we want to do with our lives. Most people in most have this similar thing. So that's a classic. It's an extreme because he's a beast, and she has to look beyond his outer look. Has to look inside the character. It's very nice. So they're the three examples of love stories. Here's my 8-step journey. Now I put this together because. And I've done it around a hero's journey, but it's just, and it's not the only beats that are in a story structure, but I just wanted to, you know, focus on 8 beats. There are many, many beats to a story, but you have to bring an audience in, make them care, take them on a journey that's entertaining, and give them a resolution that they find satisfying. Now, resolution doesn't mean to say everything is right in the world. Now, I'm talking very much family entertainment and animation is what I do. But often we go to a live action movie and we do not have the resolution that is all lovely. We often have a bitter resolution. But as long as you leave the movie theater satisfied with that challenge, of course, challenged by it, leave you thinking about it. But we've taken you, because what you want the audience to do is care at the end. And if they go to a restaurant afterwards and start talking about it amongst their friends and discussing it, you know as a filmmaker you've done something right. So, I have films that we could develop. I mean, I have films that I absolutely can't be doing. Inception is a film I just don't get. I thought we made better films in the 1960s trying to do that sort of thing. But but other people... I love that film. It speaks to them. It touched a beat. So because I like or dislike something doesn't make me right. It just means I have an opinion, as you should have an opinion. I just want you to have an opinion from a point of view of knowledge. You could disagree all you like, but you've learned and you've thought about it and you thought about structure. So an 8-step journey. I've picked Finding Nemo. I suppose 2 reasons, really. I think it's a great examples of storytelling. It has a very unusual hero, because it has a dad as the hero, not a boy. So that's really unusual, and I think fantastic. It's from Pixar, who, of course, you know, that what they've done in animation storytelling is phenomenal. I know what I said about budget earlier on. Doesn't matter how you get somewhere. Providing you have the cost to be able to support that journey. But this is a wonderful film. It has, I think, some of the finest filmmaking in the first 5 minutes of the film. Because all films are about how you set up the journey. If we're full of exposition, and I'm giving you too much information, you can't... Look, I've got a prop in my pocket. Look, I've got a sponge. Imagine this... Oh, I caught it. Hey, that's quite good. I caught it. Imagine your brain is a sponge. If there's too much information, you can't retain it, right? So when a movie starts, you have to give enough information. If you give too much information, it just runs out, as water would run out of my sponge. So there's my little prop for today. But yeah, let's take our first step. So what do we do? The setup. So you've got to tell me where we are and who we are. Give me some information. This is the reef, and this is where we live, is the example. But why don't I show you the opening few minutes of Finding Nemo? Have a look at it. It's full of information that we're going to need later on. It's just layered in there. There's a lot of information that's given to us, but it tells us so much about the character and why ultimately, when the inciting incident happens, which for me is step two, that we care and that we want to go on that journey because of this setup. So I'm going to show you a little, I think it's about 3 minutes. I'm going to turn off some lights.
Wow.
Mm.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Yes, Marlin. I see it. It's beautiful.
So, Coral, when you said you wanted an ocean view, you didn't think you were going to get the whole ocean, did you? Huh? Oh, yeah. A fish can breathe out here. Did your man deliver, or did he deliver?
My man delivered.
And it wasn't so easy.
Because a lot of other clownfish had their eyes on this place.
You better believe they did. Every single one of them.
Mm-hmm. You did good. And the neighborhood is awesome.
So you do like it, don't you?
No. I do. I really do like it. But Marlin, I know that the drop-off is desirable with the great schools and the amazing view and all that, but do we really need so much space?
Coral, honey, these are our kids we're talking about. They deserve the best. Look. They'll wake up, poke their little heads out, and they see a whale passing right by their bedroom window.
Shh, you're gonna wake the kids.
Oh, right.
They're dreaming. We still have to name them.
You want to name all of them right now? All right. We'll name this half Marlin Jr. and then this half Coral Jr. Okay, we're done.
I like Nemo.
Nemo? Well, we'll name one Nemo, but I'd like most of them to be Marlin Jr.
Just think, in a couple of days, we're going to be parents.
Yeah. What if they don't like me?
Marlin.
Oh, really?
There's over 400 eggs. Odds are one of them is bound to like you. What?
You remember how we met?
Well, I try not to.
Well, I remember. Excuse me, miss. Can you check and see if I have a hook in my lip?
Marlin!
Oh, you gotta look closer because it's way in the air.
Get away!
Here he is. Cutie's here. Where did everybody go? Get inside the house, Coral. No, Coral, don't. They'll be fine. Just get inside, you, right now. Coral?
Thank you.
I know you want the movie to keep going, right? Watch this. Just watch the movie. What do you want a story class for? Just watch the film. Because that is a wonderful, wonderful opening. Nothing like killing off 100 characters before the movie starts, right? But at the end of it, of course, you know, the object of desire is established, the object of desire being Nemo. The idea that when we start the next scene of the movie, when you've got this fearful father who is overly protective, we understand why. And then when Nemo is actually fished out of the water by a fish hook, which they mentioned in this scene, the fish hook is mentioned very cleverly. There's a discussion in there. You understand everything about it. So when you know, so you understand the fear. So when the inciting incident happens, step two, and Marlin has to leave the reef, we understand the trauma for him of that. Now, of course, this film has nothing to do with fish. This is a human story told using fish, which allows us to open up a lot. I think it's one of the powers of animation. You can open up prejudices. I've done a lot of films for UNICEF over the years, you know, trying to do films in developing countries, dealing with prejudice and things like that. It's interesting when you can approach something from an animation point of view, you can come at it obliquely. This is a very obvious step of that. But, you know, this is all of you. You're all students, right? You're all, you know, you've left home. What do your mum do all the time? She calls you. Have you washed your clothes? Are you eating properly? When are you coming home? Who lives in Shenzhen and has to go home at weekends? And, you know, that overprotective parenting, because that's what every parent goes through, the letting go. You totally look after your kids. And then there's a moment in their life when they have to go on their own journey. And that transition is so difficult. This film highlights all of that. But we set off on a journey caring about everybody, and you're telling us why we care. It's a brilliant opening. The inciting incident, thank you, Robert McKee, for this use of this word. That's where I first heard it. It's the idea that something happens in a movie. The idea that something, if it doesn't happen, the movie doesn't start. That idea of the sponge I was telling you about. You have to give... That's why Nemo's so great. This is a very exciting opening, but it's also full of information that you need to go on the storytelling journey. So the inciting incident is the moment something happens. Star Wars, I like to talk about episode 4 for a couple of reasons. I love the movie. It's probably the greatest example of a hero's journey, and most people have seen the movie. But the inciting incident in Star Wars, of course, is Luke's discovery of his aunt and uncle having been murdered. Because if it doesn't happen, yeah, he's a kid, you've met him, and he's good, and there's something weird about the relationships, but nothing's happening. It's the action that must happen, and it must happen early enough in a film. And I think as we, as our society changes, and the access to information, and the challenges that we all have with the diversions in our lives of information coming to us so quickly, you know, people are, you know, of course, like me, people are on their iPhones right here, right now, doing it. They're either taking notes or they're talking to somebody. It's fine. It's what life is. It's not about stopping it. It's about how you embrace it and bringing it in. Nevertheless, it's really important in these films that you have that moment where grabs you and you go off on the journey. So something happens. It's also known as the call to adventure. In Nemo, of course, it's the moment Nemo disappears, leaving Marlin with that decision. That's the inciting incident. And off he goes on his journey. He goes off into step 3, which I call ready, steady, go, but it's that decision to go. We're off on the adventure. It's somewhere in act 1. He's got to go. Something happens, but he has to take that decision to go. And we leave. Luke takes the decision to go off. He doesn't stay there. And he goes off to find Obi-Wan, right? And the story unfolds. We haven't told the audience the story, but we've told them enough to make them interested and care about this character. It also goes down to, you know, great script, but, you know, a great performance, great dialogue. There's many elements. But this is number 3. Number 4... it is really the journey, and you can look at the journey as act 2, really. I touched on it earlier. I mentioned Karate Kid, but you know, for Luke Skywalker, you know, he's got to become a Jedi. It's also quite interesting with heroes' journeys as the central character is educated. So are we. It's very important. Han Solo is a hero. We don't identify with him in the same way. When you take a student, when you take somebody who's young, Harry Potter, you become the hero as they do. You get through the training. But for Marlon, you know, he has to adapt. He's got to start experimenting. He starts to get it together. He's not whole. He's making terrible mistakes, but he's learning. So Act Two is that, it could often be that journey. You want to see the character evolve. A character's not flatlined. If you think of television series that you love, and I'm not talking about the wonderful change in TV that we're all enjoying so much, where we can have TV shows that do not have to be a whole story within a singular episode, which is what we've lived for so badly for so many years. But essentially, you know, in TV shows, the characters don't change. We know the character and we throw things at them, and what's amusing and what's interesting is how they react to those. But in a movie, the character must evolve. They must change. They go on a journey. They don't flatline. They're experiencing something, and like in our own lives, as we experience things, we change, we adapt, we become capable, and we see these characters become capable. And often, I didn't touch on the last one, which is being broken down. Often you go down to, you know, real basics. But then, you know, step five, you'll find something. You know, he succeeded. You tempt the audience. You put something out there. Oh, okay, we know what we're doing. Star Wars, they're off to find, they know they've got, I can't remember the name of the planet. Where are they going? They're going to Alderaan, right? They've got to get to Alderaan. It's a big part of the, you know, that's the journey. They've got to get to Alderaan, so you tempt them. You find it. You know what we're going to be looking for, but then you've got to figure out, how do we get there? In Star Wars, they go to that place, they hire a pilot, and they go on their journey. So they're starting to figure things out as we see Marlon start to figure out the journey of how to get to where Nemo is. And we see them growing and learning and breaking down. Number six, this is the curveball. We love a curve. Hey guys, I was doing my American accent for you. Hey, it's a curveball. It's a baseball expression, but it comes from the word, you know, you curve the ball. Something odd happens, not unexpected, and it's the end of Act Two. You can create these wonderful down moments. I love in animation, particularly, we can manipulate your sensibilities through color. We can take, you know, we love. Did you see in Nemo at the beginning? Once at the beginning it's all bright colors, and then the shark, you know, arrives and they all get eaten. When we cut back, guess what? All the colors are muted. The sun's gone. Act three in a live action movie, when all is lost, it's always raining outside. It's always raining. You try and do things that just push that to you. You don't have a bright sunny day. You have a bad day, you take them down. So these are these moments. This end of Act Three, you throw something. We think we know what we're doing. Now in Star Wars, Alderaan is, they found Alderaan, it's all fine. Oh no, it's not. There's a Death Star about to blow us up. So there's the we've succeeded. The whole goal of the movie was to get to Alderaan, to get there and join forces with them. No, they get there, but it's too late. But Luke has been in training. Now he's capable. So all of the things that he's learned, he can now put together. But every single moment of these films, every single incident that happens in these films happens for a reason, not just for individual entertainment. And that's why you always need to be careful about secondary characters, as I said earlier. They're there to serve a purpose, to support the journey, not to separately entertain, unless it's a secondary plot line that makes sense. It always has to drive the story forward. So step seven is the triumphant finale. It is the moment when we rescue, when Marlon rescues Nemo, when they reunite. It is the moment where Luke Skywalker turns off the computer and feels the Force. And the wonderful thing about Star Wars is the entire audience is shouting, "Feel the Force," before Obi-Wan Kenobi says it, because we know, because you've been manipulated. You're now a Jedi. The whole audience is a Jedi Knight. We know. Luke, turn it off. So when he does, We're doing something we wanted him to do, and we're totally engaged. And that's the triumph. That's the finale, but it's not the end of the movie. Because with all movies, I think there's a step eight. And that, particularly with a journey where the characters have evolved, it's this idea life will never be the same. For Nemo, yeah, this was a child who his father had to go and find, an overprotective father. What's happened in the journey for Marlin? He's now back to the character that he was at the very beginning of the movie. He's reconciled what happened. He's understood the journey, and he's understood the concept of letting go as we let go of our children and learn when they come back full circle. I got a 30-year-old and a 27-year-old, and they're still tiny little kids to me. They always will be the little kids, but I have a relationship now which has evolved, and it's different. We're now adults. I think when parenting can go wrong is that inability to allow the child to evolve and grow. And Nemo is a wonderful reflection of that. It's the main theme of the movie. When we talk about what movies are about, it's not about fish. It uses fish to tell a story. It's a wonderful way of doing it. But that's not what it's about. It's about very human emotions. So it's this idea that, you know, we come full circle. We're now reunited, but we've seen all the characters grow, particularly Marlin. So that's my little eight-step journey. I'm going to go to the next slide, which is, yeah, and I think, you know, as you're writing a story, and it's that idea of challenging yourself. When you come up with a good idea, I like to say, why and how? It's a self thing I use. And it's just to try and second guess myself, really, question myself. Why does something need to happen? You know, why? Because you often get a great idea that would be really cool and look cool, but why? Is it really helping the story? Because this is where we can get diverted. You always come back to what the core idea is. And so anything that happens in the movie must serve the core idea. You know, how will it happen? Just question it. Because to keep focus, what is Finding Nemo about? It's the ability for Marlin to evolve, to grow up, to come back to the character he wants, to get over his fear, to find his son. Yeah, that's the object of the desire, but it's the change in his character which is so important. And who he meets is so important that develops his character. I thought it was why, if you saw the second movie with the female character, Ellen DeGeneres' character, that movie didn't work for me. Because she's a secondary character. And although she's a delightful character, she's a secondary character. I think they had real trouble with the fact she couldn't remember anything. I think it was a real challenge. I think, you know, when films don't work, I think they're almost more important for learning than when they do work. Because when a film doesn't work, find out why. Why didn't you like it? Why didn't it grab you? What was wrong? Okay, breaking the rules, because I've been talking formula, and we can get very upset with Hollywood or ways of telling stories. Don't go there. Don't ever go there. All our storytelling could be based on the ancient stories of the Silk Road, the Greeks, Shakespeare, all our great writers. It's an evolution. All of these people had formulas, manipulated you. Take any Shakespearean play, Shakespeare grabs you very quickly. You know, the opening line of Othello, "Prithee, never tell me. Prithee, never tell me." Tell you what, this is Cassio running on stage and Iago is falling. And Iago is immediately saying in his ear. And he's saying, no, don't tell me. But yeah, so you're straight into it. You're grabbed. Something is happening. So breaking the rules. First rule. Know the rules you're breaking. So it's good to break rules. People say Pulp Fiction is a rule-breaking film. No, it's not. It's a beautiful film, edited so carefully, so beautifully to cut it in the middle. You lay that out. But he's not breaking any rules of storytelling. He's just telling you the story in a different order. but it's not a breaking of storytelling rules. So it's my talk today is not about not challenging yourself and not pushing it, but never get yourself in a place that you want to make a formulaic movie. Well, there's a great difference between the word formula. Oh yeah, hang on, I've jumped ahead slightly. I think it's really, it's this, we've talked about it with Nemo. What is the story really about? What is the theme? It's fish, but that's not what the film is. We're using fish. So it's finding out what the story is really about. When you know what the story is really about, then all those story beats that will unfold that story become obvious, and it'll become obvious when they don't help you unfold the story. Perhaps you've just come up with an idea for another movie, for another story. Let it go in that direction. Formula versus formulaic. Formula good, formulaic bad. Formulaic is when you can see the formula. You can feel, you get ahead of the writer. You get ahead of the director. You can finish the movie. Get ahead of them. That's when it's formulaic. They're all formulas. When it's formulaic, it's because the formula isn't working. Because it's obvious, we're not doing it, you haven't made the audience care. But that's what so don't be ever frightened of the word formula. Don't be frightened of it. Be frightened of you not doing it properly. But you need this great story, you need a believable world, and of course you need engaging characters. But try and embrace all of the traditions. All of the, and it's not just about filmmakers, it's about going to the theater, it's plays, it's any form of storytelling. Take that audience, take it, learn how to do it, and then challenge it, and then push it. You should always push everything, all the time, but don't just do it because you don't want to do what everyone else does. Learn what everyone else does, then do it. Then break a rule, and then justify why it's okay to put Act 3 at the beginning of a movie, whatever it is. Hey, we've seen Mulholland Drive. It's a very interesting movie. Those of you who see Mulholland Drive, it's told backwards, right? It's very interesting. It's very, 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 it's a great movie. So, but he's not breaking the rules. He just told it in a different way. He didn't, So, enough of that. So that's my talk on story. And we're going to go on to pitching. And how are we doing on time? Oh, not bad. I was going to try and leave time for Q&A. Eva is sitting in front of me, so she'll tell me when I really have to finish, right? If I go on. Oh, I can stay till tomorrow, apparently. Okay, great. Okay, all right, good. So once you've created a story, now for the pitching. Now, pitching's interesting. But of course, the ability to pitch, it could be pitching to your, in your class. You've got your idea for your film, and you have to pitch, you have to explain what it is. So pitching can be, I've got an entire movie with a script fully developed. I've got an animation test. I've got a budget and a schedule and everything else like that. Or it can be just the idea. So it's whatever you have that you're trying to get something, get an approval, get development money, whatever it is. So it's almost like a cake. You might be taking a slice out of the cake, and it's wherever you are in your process because you've met somebody who could help you. And I think the part of the core idea of pitching is about preparation and just being prepared for the unexpected. So I'm going to focus a little bit on that. Let's get into this. So the pitch. So what is a pitch? It's baseball, right? That's how I think of pitch. They pitch the ball at you, and it comes in different ways. So I think a pitch should be this: the core idea without sharing every story point. And it's the idea of, if you were pitching Nemo, what is it about? It's coming of age, it's about a fish, about something. But it's the evolution of the characters, that core idea you want to always try and explain. You know what it is. There's a great quote. Define your story, if you can define your story in one short paragraph. These are good exercises for you. Because there's a quote I've got a quote. I'll have to come back to it. I've just wanted to tell you a quote. But this, the elevator pitch is very, very famous. And in what I'm about to say, it doesn't really mean that you're going to jump in an elevator and pitch somebody because you're in the elevator with somebody famous. But it is the concept that we know that people are only in an elevator for a very short amount of time. So it's the, and it forces that thing. So you're in the elevator, you've jumped in, and literally as the doors are closing, an arm comes in, And the door opens, and lo and behold, it's Steven Spielberg. And he presses the 18th floor. Well, first of all, you press the 6th, but you're going to pretend that somebody else must have opened the door, you know. And now, you're alone with him in an elevator. What would you do? What would you do in, 18, 20, 28 seconds if you could, if your heart didn't stop pounding, right, which would be the first thing, right? Your mouth didn't dry up, and you said something. What would you say? Well, you can't pitch your entire movie. So what could you say? Now, let's use the Finding Nemo idea of it's a fish. I mean, you've got bait on the end of a hook. All you're trying to do is get him to take the bait, and you say something. And then he says, you're the cheekiest person I've ever met, but here's my card. Call my office, and you tell my assistant that you're the person who pitched me in the elevator and that you're to come in and see me. That would be the equivalent of the elevator pitch. But it could be anywhere. It's anywhere. It's that idea. But what people would tend to say in a situation like that would be to excuse themselves. Oh, Mr. Spielberg, if only I'd known you were going to be in the elevator with me, I would have been prepared. Well, you just went past 3 floors. So you've wasted time. So it's the idea of preparation. You never say to somebody, if only I'd known. Well, you're not going to know. That's the idea. It's these chance meetings, these chance opportunities. And that's what the definition of the elevator pitch means. It's a casual encounter, unexpected, and you take advantage of it to get in the room with somebody. But if you overload them with information, or it's not clear and concise as to what your idea is, then you're lost. So, if you can't explain it simply, you don't know it well enough. This is a quote of Einstein's, and it's really interesting. It's got nothing to do with storytelling, has it? He uses it. He uses the idea of a pitch. I've invented something, I've got a concept, but I need to be able to explain it to people who don't understand all the jargon and all the formulas behind it. I just need to be able to tell you what it is, what it's going to do for you. And so we need to adopt this idea all the time. You need to be explaining it simply. It can be the most complicated story. It could be Game of Thrones, but you still would need to explain it simply. Because if I need to understand the relationships between all the characters in Game of Thrones, I have a problem with my sponge, with my little brain. I can't retain all this information you're giving me. So you're trying to get me to want to hear more in another situation. So imagine that you've been given your 30 minutes. Okay, so this would be the pitch. You've been given your 30 minutes, right? And you've shown up, and now you're expected to give the pitch. You've got your meeting. You're not going to get more than 30 minutes. You must first of all realize that the person is going to be late, distracted, and they're going to take a phone call midway through the meeting. You just expect all that. They're in a bad mood. Read the room. Read the room. You can always tell, you know, get astute on people's moods and adapt. But if you have a 30-minute window, do not have 30 minutes of material. It'd be a disaster. You still got to pitch it succinctly and leave time for the discussion. So for the unexpected. So you got, but anyway, if I was going to pitch, give me the title. So give me a title. I like to throw in the target audience pretty early. I'm going to come back to that. These are not in the necessary order, but these are things that you should do. Technique, tell me what you're doing. CGI, stop motion, doesn't matter. Just give me a, describe the world very briefly. The challenge the characters are going to face, the theme of the idea, the journey, the resolution, the victory. You try and cover these in that very short way, but in that is that theme of it, what you're exploring. You know there's sayings, there are only 5 jokes in the world, right? They're all a variation. So any story you come up with is on a variation of something that already exists. We were having a conversation with Manda and Ivy earlier this morning on the car here when I said Harry Potter and Star Wars and Terminator are actually the same idea. And because I'm in a Baptist university, the relationship between Herod and Christ is exactly the same as well. Because there's something just been born who will become all powerful, and you've got to get to him before that happens. They're not the same movies, but they're certainly the same setups, and that's fine. So whenever you're pitching something, your idea is a variation on an idea. It's not completely original. Don't worry about that. You're a variation. You don't need to say what the variation is, but get down to its core. What are you exploring? But don't be so that you're completely original. Your telling of the idea is what's completely original. So there's my recurring sponge. It's that same idea. What happens when the sponge is full? We can't retain anymore. So what I want you to be in a pitch, if you're pitching me, is I might not like the idea. I might already have a similar movie. It may not be the type of movie that I want to make. I want you to know that you want to make it. I want you to be committed. Some people sometimes ask me, you know, what sort of movie am I looking for? As though they can then provide it. Don't do that. Just, you've got an idea, you're pitching it. Be absolutely 100% committed to the idea. Next one, be concise. So this is the same idea. Get to the point. Tell me what the idea is. Don't waffle. Don't go all over the place. Be concise. Get straight to the heart of it. This comes back to that idea of a paragraph that I was talking about. Explain it. Once the person goes, okay, I get what the type of idea this is, then you can go off and things. And then third of all, no excuses. And I can't tell you, we all do this. We all do the, if only I'd known, or I left my artwork, or the artwork that my friend was supposed to deliver for me, which was the character designs, it hasn't arrived. And so I don't have them. There's no point in saying that in the meeting. There's absolutely no point. Telling me something, I'd be seeing something that I'm not seeing and telling me why I'm not seeing it, you're just wasting time. You are absolutely committed to wherever you are in the process of your development. Do not tell people what they're not seeing or you'll have the script next week or only if I'd known I was going to be meeting you. Do not do it. No excuses. Be committed, be concise. Don't excuse yourself. If you do these things, and I reject your idea, but you call again to pitch another project, you will get a meeting. Because I will go, oh my God, I love that person. I hated their idea. That was awful. But they were committed. They came in. I understand. Because I've rejected projects because I didn't know what they were. Because I couldn't understand the pitch. It was just, my sponge was full. My head was spinning. I didn't know what they were pitching. They went all over the place. They were excusing themselves. They weren't concise. They weren't really believing in their idea. They're not coming back. But the person who is committed, doesn't excuse themselves, and is concise will always get invited back. Because I can give them a few minutes because they're not going to waste time. Use it. I have 5 minutes. Don't use six. In fact, you've got 30 minutes. You use as few minutes as you can to leave time for discussion. Or if the person doesn't like the, I want to pitch Jeffrey Katzenberg. I pitched him this great idea, which I thought was a great idea. He was in and out of the pitch within 10 minutes, having rejected it. But at the end of it, I went, did we do a good job? Did we tell him what the idea was? He said he got what the idea was and then rejected it. But he didn't reject it because he wasn't interested. He understood what it was. He said, it's not for me. He didn't say it was a bad idea. He just said it wasn't for him. But he understood what we were pitching, and the pitch lasted 12 minutes. We were in and out. It was 7:30 in the morning, which is very Jeffrey Katzenberg, to get these weird times to show up and pitch it. Not the best time, 7:30 in the morning. But I gave him some minutes back in his day. I was booked for 30. He got 16, 17 minutes back. That's also something people will appreciate. Also, the interruption. You know, the meeting could start by saying to your assistant, hold all calls. I don't want to talk, just while I'm hearing this pitch, no calls. And then the phone goes. Well, if the phone goes or there's an interruption, you know something very important just happened. So go with the flow. Don't get in the way of that. But the idea that you're concise and you've left time for these things that go wrong. He's stuck in traffic. He's had to take a call, or she has had to take a call. Whatever that diversion is, the effect on you should be minimal. And it'll be minimal if you're concise and to the point, and you'll always get invited back. And particularly if something like that happens and goes wrong, that person you're pitching to it feels that they have not given you the time they wanted to. Right? They will feel, and you will be invited back or whatever. So always do those three things. Be ready to answer this question. I don't know what the question is. Let's see what I can remember. What do you want? I'll tell you what you want. I'll tell you what most people want. Most people don't want to screw up the pitch. They don't want to throw up. You know, when I do these talks, in fact, Manda and I were talking this morning. They found me doing some vocal exercises before I started this morning. It goes back to my old theater days. Some breathing exercises. Often I speak way too fast. Well, I always speak a little bit too fast. But I have a vocal exercise that I do. Peter Piper picked a peck of pickled peppers. Peter Piper picked a peck of pickled peppers, just to get my tongue moving. Red lorry, yellow lorry, red lorry, yellow lorry. It's not rocket science. It's just what actors do. Because you're suddenly going to start talking. You know, make sure you've got water there. Do some exercises, perhaps some breathing exercises, because you should be nervous. You should always be nervous. Don't channel fear into adrenaline. Channel it, control it, expect it, celebrate it, take it in. If you think I can stand up in front of all of you this morning and just walk on and appear to be, no. I have to do something. So I'm speaking to 300 people, for goodness sake, from all different countries, different levels of experience. I sit there going, oh my God, is it, you know, but you have to have that. You got to have some apprehension, some nervousness, but don't be frightened of it. Embrace it, take it. So do a little vocal exercise, do some breathing. You are about to be a performer, right? Pitching, you have to learn to pitch. You've got to learn because the reason you start making excuses is because you get nervous and you lose your way a little bit. And you have to overcome that. You have to channel that. And you can learn. And these are exercises to do that. You have to do it in class. That's why you're students and you're learning. But learn to pitch. It's not about having a great idea. It's about having an idea that you can explain, whether it's good or bad or not. But learn to express yourself. Learn to control it. And learn to feel you're not alone. And learn to feel that if you're not nervous, you've got a real problem. You know, you ever hear stories of comedians, famous comedians? They're notorious for actually being physically sick before they walk on the stage. I mean, many stories. Some of the greatest comedians you will have ever heard of. This balance between the anticipation of forgetting what they were going to say next. Actors have it. Everybody has it. You are in that same arena. You're going to suddenly be in front of somebody who is powerful. And by power, I mean money. They're going to be able to open the door for you. So why? Of course you're going to be nervous. But you need to be prepared and all the way things I've said. So, all right. But this, what do you want? Is really, most people's I want, I don't want to screw up. I don't want to throw up. I want to do, no. What do you want? So when I turn around to the interview and say, I love this pitch. Ivy, I loved your pitch. I love to talk to Michael or Eva. I loved your pitch. What do you want? What do you want? Well, I would like X million dollars. I would like this. I would like to be. I think it helps you focus on success. I mean, this is that sort of. I could write one of those guru books on this sort of subject now because this is visualization time. Visualize what you want. What do I want? I want an approval. I want whatever it is. You want money, you want them to buy your movie. Whatever you want, decide what it is and fixate on it. And that becomes the purpose of the meeting. Because you would love somebody to turn around and say to you, what do you want? Whereas what we want really in our hearts is not to screw up. Get past that. Get over that. Get to what you do. What do I want? So what do you want? Know your audience. And I think there's two parts to knowing your audience. Who are you pitching to? What movies have they done? Who are you in front of? What movies do they like? So know what's going on. That's a little bit of research. Research is so easy to do nowadays. Just get on there, check their IMDb credits, see what movies they made, see what types of movies they made, see if they've ever made a movie that you're pitching. Just be knowledgeable, all right, about their background. But also, there's a second part of this, knowing your audience. Who is your movie for? And when people pitch me, they try and tell me that their movie's for everyone. They say, oh, it's for everyone. And my respond is, okay, so you're telling me that you got a movie that's okay for three-year-olds and it's going to be okay for 93-year-olds. And you didn't mean that, did you? You didn't mean it was okay for a 32-year-old unmarried soccer star. You didn't mean it was just everybody, because I'm going to ask you what's in it for them. And particularly when you come to children, and you only have to look at your own background, your own childhood, is that you know that an 11 or 12-year-old will not go and see a movie that's suitable for a three-year-old. It's not going to be there. So I want you to be much more... Because the temptation is, you want to endear the film to me because you want to tell me that you're going to make so much money from my idea because everyone's going to love it. I know that. I will know who it's for by hearing the pitch. I know that. You don't need to tell me. So I'm testing you to see if you know who it's for, because I don't want that sort of big, bland, broad audience. Tell me who is the target audience, and you can visualize this. By what I call the ripple effect, which is if you drop a pebble in a lake that hasn't, you know, that's completely smooth. It's early in the morning, it's completely flat and smooth. Drop a pebble. That's the core demographic. The ripples are everybody else. That could be siblings. It could be parents who you're going to drop enough into the movie to keep them entertained. But it isn't just for everybody. There's a core audience, boy, girl, whatever it is, but be truthful. And if you are going to say it's for everyone, be ready for the question. Explain yourself. Tell me more about that idea. You don't mean everyone. Figure out who your movie's for. If you could be wrong, I might disagree with you, but at least I go, yeah, you had an opinion. I want to give an example of a movie that I did think crossed many. I mean, Lion King did for us at Disney. I don't know why. It crossed. But Incredibles, I think, is a movie set up that does have many demographics because of the family aspect of it. You've got a little boy and a little girl and the parents, and they're all superheroes. And so that has a pretty broad demographic. It still doesn't go wild. It still doesn't go three-year-olds to 93-year-olds. But, so you can get them. But just be honest with what you're pitching, and it's fine. Movies don't have to be for everyone. If all movies were for everyone, we'd be making some pretty dull movies. And because we find ourselves restricted. Here's a movie that I like to, here's a demo of a movie that didn't work, trying to get every demo. Anyone see Rise of the Guardians? Yeah, one or two hands went up. Okay, so Rise of the Guardians was an attempt by DreamWorks to satisfy their development needs to produce two or three movies a year. So they went looking. It's very hard when you want movies. It's really hard to find them when you want them. And so somebody came up with an idea that you'd have a sort of gang of superheroes. Well, it started flashing red, thank you. So this movie was a good idea at the pitch because you had the Easter Bunny, Santa, Father Christmas, the Sandman, who am I missing? Oh, and the Tooth Fairy. And each one of those characters was designed to target a different demographic. And there was a hero, and there was a villain, and it ended up satisfying nobody because it tried to do everything and fail. It's a very good movie to look at from that point of view. But the motivation was that DreamWorks needed content, and they thought they could establish all these characters in one movie, and then each of these characters would spin off into their own movie for their correct demographic. So the Tooth Fairy would be for little kids. Santa, for some reason, had tattoos and would be for older kids. It was a very odd concept. So well worth a look. Your movie title, be careful. Use it. It's like a log line. Use it to... You know, Finding Nemo is a classic. The Lion King, Bambi, Beauty and the Beast. But often people get movie titles that are really weird. This is the weirdest movie title. The Legends of the Guardians, The Owls of Gahul. Now, you could... Yeah, I know, it's great, isn't it? You could sometimes do a long movie title because you can't understand it. It can become intriguing. But be careful with that type of idea. Because of this reason, when you come to market the movie, you end up with a movie poster on Sunset Boulevard in Los Angeles, and you realize this is 40 foot wide, and you can't read the title because you can't make the letters big enough and fit them on the poster. So you get in a mess. So be careful about doing that sort of stuff. Make it work for you. Here's an example of a bad movie title that worked brilliantly. Despicable Me is not an appropriate name for a movie, but all movies, great movies, can overcome bad titles. But why do that? But what actually happened was that this was the original movie poster, and somebody in a marketing meeting said, "Guys, anybody got a problem with this image? An old man with four little children leading them away. Has anyone got a problem with that? And he's called Despicable. How do you feel about that?" Now, you never thought of that, but once I say it to you, then you think about it, right? And that's what happened in a marketing meeting. You know what they did? They did another poster and called the movie Despicable, and that was the main opening of the movie. So that's a very powerful... They overcame the title. And once the movie was released, it was fine. But don't give yourselves unnecessary challenges with a title. Make the title work for you. Make it work for your pitch. Make it support what you're doing. It's part of it. In fact, the first thing I put up on that list was title. Give me a title. But don't ever tell me it's a legend of something. I hate that. You know, the great movie titles are often single words. Finding Nemo's great because it also tells us what the movie's what the intent's going to be. But The Lion King, Bambi, Beauty and the Beast, Shrek, you know, often the central character's name is fine. But don't make them overcomplicated. They're not log lines. They're not log lines. So this little recap, really. So we got title, target audience, technique, world, you know, just challenge, journey. And you know, the level of detail in each of these is dependent on the amount of time you're holding up something. Q&A. Yes, he was going, get onto the Q&A. She's got a whip out down here. She's about to do this. So is there a budget? Is there a schedule? Depending on where you are. You know, a pitch can contain many, many things. Can just be the idea, as I said, you know. What to leave behind? Well, anything you have. And in terms of that elevator pitch, why not have something in your pocket? But, you know, you could have a screenplay, a full story, a Bible, a budget and schedule, a whole design pack. You might even have an animation test. You know, soft copies, hard copies. I like this one. This is a little business card, which is actually has information on it, you know, but it looks like a business card. And I carry this one around in my pocket because I have projects sitting on that. You could have something like that. It's a business card, has your name on it. So all sorts of little tricks you can have to always be ready. But how much you need in the package is just where you are. And if you have a need, you just got to, you know, just be ready with what you're pitching. You don't have to have everything. So be committed, be concise, no excuses. And avoid the hook, right? You don't want to be pulled off. You don't want somebody, you know, when you read the audience all the time, you see, Eva just went Q&A, get to the Q&A, get to the Q&A. You're losing the audience, get to the Q&A. The voice, she's giving me the hook. Get me off. And just be ready for what I always call the brief encounter, which is a favorite film of mine, David Lean, Noel Coward movie, Trevor Howard and Celia Johnson, but brief encounter. Just always be ready for that moment. It can happen anytime, anywhere. If you have an idea, just always have it ready. No big deal. You're not chasing people down hallways. You're not in hotel lobbies waiting for Steven Spielberg to check in and jump in the elevator with him. I don't mean that. You're just ready for the chance encounter. I love this quote of Walt Disney's. Fantasy, if it's really convincing, can't become dated for the simple reason that it represents a flight into a dimension that lies beyond the reach of time. It is the magic of what we have in animation. I'm going to put it up in Mandarin for you, that particular quote. Hopefully it's accurate. It is one of the great things about animation. It's astonishing. We can talk about films. I can talk about films that were made 20, 25 years ago, and they're still seen by today's children. As I saw Bambi when, you know, it was made in 1941 and 1942, I've seen Bambi, and it's not because it's my industry, it's because it's part of an education. And just like classic storybooks continue to entertain generation after generation, once animation came along, it did the same thing. So the timelessness of animation is so extraordinary because from a financial point of view, it continues to make money and inspire other things, other rides in theme parks. I mean, it's built, the whole of the Walt Disney empire is built on a foundation of animation, this idea that these films keep on giving because they're timeless. And live action is not timeless. You can set it. Just seeing the actors, you know that actor is now 20, 30 years older, so it dates it. Mickey Mouse doesn't get older, and these characters don't get older. So this was a moment for me when I was I'd been working in animation for about 2 years. My daughter, when I went to America, was an infant, and she grew up there, and it's one of the reasons I went to America. New baby, just been born. It sounded like a wonderful adventure. And this movie was re-released in movie theaters around the advent of VHS tapes, that suddenly we discovered that we could sell the movies by putting them on a tape, but we would release them in the movie theaters first. And I took my daughter, she was probably 3.5 years old, and I took her to the movies to see 101 Dalmatians, a re-release of it. It's the first film I can remember being taken to see by my parents. And of course, I found myself watching her watching the movie. This movie shot in 1:3:3, made in 1959 or 60, and I'm looking at this film. She's on the edge of her seat, and she's watching this film. This film has been made just for her, not for anybody else. This is her film, and she's loving it. And then that moment was that moment when I realized that what we do in animation is timeless, and that the idea that I have a connection with my daughter, because I saw this when I was probably a little older than she was, but as a boy, my first film. And then I started thinking she would take her children to see films that I'd worked on. Not as an exercise, you've got to go and see granddad's movie, oh my God, you know, but as pure entertainment. And I saw the magic of animation in a completely different light. And I've been fortunate enough to have a wonderful career working in animation. And the hairs on the back of my neck stood up in that moment of realization. And hey guys, that's my talk on story and pitching. And it's been a pleasure to speak to you all this morning. So thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Eva says I can do some Q&A, so there'll be a microphone coming around, I'm sure. I'm going to bring a little stool up here. So let's have a question. I've got somebody in the front row. Immediately, yeah, there's my.
Thanks, Max, for a very inspirational talk. I remember, at the very beginning, the beginning of your talk, you know, as you can hear, actually, you know, my heart is pumping and my mouth is drying, but I'm trying to look in the future in a positive way. So get back to the question I wanted to ask. So at the very beginning of your talk, you teased us with this question. So that question I wanted to get back to, the question I want to ask you, that question, which is, so why didn't a Chinese studio make Mulan or Kung Fu Panda?
Well, it's a bad experience in teaching and training. I think really it is at the heart of it. So why didn't China make Mulan? Well, you will certainly make Two Butterflies or the other films to follow, but it's about. I mean, I've heard Chinese filmmakers that in China you have a four-act structure. I mean, that's a BS. You don't really. you bring somebody in, you take them on a journey, and you give them an ending. It doesn't matter if you can call it four if you like, but don't. It's making something accessible. Now, I saw The Monkey King, which was very successful 2 or 3 years ago, right? Took a lot of money here, and it's not bad. It's a little inconsistent. The filmmakers had terrible trouble making it. 8 years in the making. Money, they had money, they didn't have money, so there's an inconsistency, but I thought it was pretty good. The Monkey King is a challenging story to tell for foreign audiences because it's not a story in itself, it's a way of life. The journey to the West is a journey to enlightenment, and the enlightenment itself is the journey. And it was spectacularly successful here because audiences already knew The Monkey King, whereas foreign audiences couldn't grasp that out of the movie. He's too challenging a character. And it didn't work overseas. It did sell overseas, but it didn't do very well. For me, the imagination of many Chinese filmmakers begins and ends with The Monkey King. I can't tell you how many people are always making The Monkey King. Stop it. Stop it. You know, there are other great stories. If Disney had wanted to make the greatest and most famous Chinese character in an animated film, they probably would have chosen The Monkey King, but you look at it and you go, that's something else. It's not really, but Mulan is a great, because we understood her sacrifice of those, you know, her father has to go into the military, he's too old and sick to go, but every family must send somebody, there's no brothers, so she goes, and she becomes a great warrior and leader, and it's based on a true story, right, I believe, yes. Has a great lesson in there. It's very powerful because, of course, it's a very strong feminine female character. I don't think you had the ability to, in those days, to make it in animation. I've been talking a lot about, there's a lot of studios who, when I look at their reel, their work's terrible. And you have to remember that everyone needs a chance. You need a budget, leadership, great story, and then all the artists will excel. They're completely capable of doing it, but they need the chance. So they need the great script. Now we're seeing some, US box office, I'm talking live action now, US box office last year in China was down 24%. We've seen a huge increase in regional cinemas in China. You could argue that the regional cinemas, the audience in the regional areas are not as hooked on Western content, and so are not as predisposed to want to see Western films. But also the China, I'm talking live action now, Chinese filmmakers are becoming much better. Really great storytellers, great art direction. So they've learned and now making their own versions of it. And you can look at, you know, go around Shanghai, there's some wonderful fashion designers in Shanghai, I mean, in China generally, great fashion designers. And they're designing in a way that's accessible to everybody, but they have a particular look and style. They're not changing the fundamentals that it's a piece of clothing that you wear. It's not a three-legged trouser but there's something wonderful pulling on their own culture and coming together and making those things very attractive, and they become an export. And I think, you know, Xi Jinping, the premier of China, is talking a lot about the new Silk Road and exporting culture to the West. It's where I feel, you know, we have a role to play in that, to make these stories accessible to the outside. So in answer, Mulan was made 20 years ago. I don't think here we were capable or understood the method of storytelling, or that it would be possible. I think when you look at some of these stories, I mean, look at Two Butterflies, which I particularly like this story. For those of you who don't know Two Butterflies, a girl wants an education. So I love that idea. But it's in ancient China. It's at a time when girls were not educated. I thought immediately, I picked up on that. I went, oh, that's great, because there's a few countries around the world that could learn this lesson, mainly all in the Middle East, you know, where women are not allowed to be themselves. They had to fit into a man's world. So this girl pleads with her father to go for an education, but dresses up as a boy. So she goes to get an education as a boy. Of course, she falls in love, because she's a student age. She falls in love with a boy at the school. She can't tell the boy at the school that she's a girl, because she'll lose her place in the school. So it creates a wonderful, terrible conflict. That's the first half of the movie. The movie sort of is in two parts. The second part of the movie is when their love is discovered and they do want to become together, and then her family won't accept him because he's from a lower class. And in the end of the movie, unlike Romeo and Juliet, who teaches us the same thing, where Shakespeare kills Romeo and Juliet, they die, leaving a lesson to everybody else, is they died because of how we treated them. Oh no, in China, they evolve, they metamorphosize, and they fly away as two butterflies in a world that's only their world, and you can't go there. I just love this story. Now China can make this film. You can make this. There are many others. There's a great superhero story, Ten Brothers. You know, there's... Anyway, that's why. I don't think capable. That was a very long answer to a lovely question. Thank you. Yes, I'm going to the back now.
Oh, I'll be there. Okay. Hi, Max. I am an entertainment journalist from Manila, so I'll try to summarize my two questions. You're picking up from live animation because a lot of the movies now that you have been part of Lion King, Aladdin are now actually being done in live animation. So what are your thoughts about it? And what are some of the parts of animation that can be adapted to live animation based on what's happening?
What will be interesting about it? Well, I think it's just marvelous that a film can get remade in using another format. I think that's so interesting. What I think will happen, and this will be the test of time, I wonder if the live-action version of Beauty and the Beast will be looked at in 20 years' time. I think that'll be the... And I suspect it won't, because it will date. It has to date. Oh, you know, I was on a long flight. I only arrived yesterday, and I flew in from London, and on the movie was Godfather Part 2. And I found myself watching it and being completely... once again riveted by this masterpiece. And I felt in certain respects it hadn't dated in terms of its filmmaking, its editing. Unfortunately though, all the actors are going, he's dead. Oh, Al Pacino's, you know. And then I watched Godfather Part 3, which I thought was a pretty terrible movie. But it had dated. But I was looking at it as an historical piece of filmmaking, thinking, and if, perhaps a patronizing way, badly, but what a wonderful movie it is. But I looked at it historically, and we don't look at animation historically. That was one question. I can't remember what the second one was.
What are the changes? Basically, what do you think will the live animation be able to adopt from the animation?
Well, I think, I don't know. I think possibly anything could. I think it's one of the important things for any studio filmmaking is decide what is the best way to tell a story. That's why I don't particularly say I prefer CGI over hand-drawn animation over stop motion. I think these are techniques that allow you to tell stories. Choose your technique. Now, all of you will have a particular expertise in one of those areas, but as a leadership, aspect of that, a studio should take a decision about what's the best technique to use, and it could be that they say it's live action. Okay, another question. So somebody down here. Yes, sir.
Thank you, Max. Quick questions. You was talking about the formula and formulaic, and I know there's a major production in the Western world portraying like different racial issues, the people being stereotyped in different ways. Particularly in Hollywood production, the Chinatown is not really a good place to stay. And I'm just questioning is that inevitable that the people have been portrayed that way for the market or for saving
Well,
money?
I mean, I think it is one of the things we're coming to terms with, you know, the whole Me Too movement, the treatment and the stereotyping of everything, particularly minorities. You know, you talk to the black community, whenever there's a part for a black actor. In fact, there's a great documentary. I think BBC were running it about, you know, I can't remember the title, but essentially it's black actors ultimately becoming successful in Hollywood and starting to play roles that are not stereotypical of who we think they are, like gang members, drug, you know, talking, you know, hip and hip hop, you know, that they genuinely are people. And I think that's a move forward, long overdue. But I mean, I do think we have a challenge with it. I think it's a challenge. You know, there's a very good animated film made a few years ago called Bebe's Kids with Bruce Smith. And Bruce is, he was one of the co-directors of Space Jam. Bruce is an African-American. And it'd be interesting. So he made a film, and it was all the characters are black. So when the characters are, because in animation, we tend to caricature everything, right? Because that's what it is. You're doing a drawing, you know, so easily. So when a white person does a caricature of a drawing, you're in a very difficult area because animation tends to push everything, you know, and so we can force ourselves into some very weird places. The pure fact it's being talked about is such a fantastic departure. My daughter, who's trained as an actress, of course, followed in her mum's footsteps and my father's, you know, so we have it in our... But she talks about blind casting. Now, when I was a young man, I did several productions of Othello with white actors putting black makeup on. And I can remember, I was a PA, basically. I was the runner, but I got exposed to very famous directors and actors. I heard people openly talking about the fact that black people couldn't speak Shakespeare. I mean, can you imagine saying that today? I'm talking a little while ago. In fact, one of the productions that I'm talking about played at the third or fourth Hong Kong Arts Festival, which I came to in 1975, with actors putting on makeup to play parts, to black up. Then I took that same production to Australia, to all around Australia, a man putting black paint on him. Now, what's interesting now is that my daughter talks to me about this whole concept of blind casting. Is that you cast an actor, but you don't see the color of their skin. I've seen, and I'm not quite, I'm there conceptually with it. I mean, one of the best productions of Henry V that I've seen in recent years was one at the National Theatre in London. And I can't remember the name of the actor. I should know. But he's gone on to do great things. But a black guy playing Henry V, what's really interesting about it was the fact that he was black, to me. But the concept of blind casting is looking beyond the color of our skin, looking beyond all this is what needs to happen in all of entertainment. Sorry, I've gone off completely different. Let me go. So, okay, another question. There's a lady there who's obviously visiting. Yes, did you have your hand up just now? I did see you, but just too late.
I'm from Greece, and the first movie that I saw, I remember that was Pocahontas, and after 2 years, I watched Mulan in a Greek open air theater, and I was so excited that a movie can talk to kids' souls, and to learn more about friendships and educationally, and about families. Talking about relationships. My question is that I was growing up in the 90s, and my question is that how technology had effect to animation movies from 90s to today, because at the beginning of your...
It's how technology affected it, and it has dramatically. I love 2D. As Nick Park once said to me, who's the Aardman guy in all those great films, he should be able to convert to CGI, but he likes working with plasticine because he wants to touch the plasticine. It's tactile. The great leap forward by not doing a 2D movie is the ability to move the camera. Because when we've got flat artwork, now Beauty and the Beast, you know, I showed in my film at the beginning that, you know, we pull, as marvelous as that shot is, when the camera sweeps around the ballroom, it does pull you out of the movie because it looks so different. So CG and the ability to move the camera because you've created a world. So now I can make a movie and cut a movie like a live action film. I can do, because all I could do before was push in, pull out. And I mean, Disney did have a very elaborate multiplane camera that took about 9 people to operate, which always opened films like Bambi. You'd sort of just see a great long push in. With lots of images painting on glass and being pulled out, but I think that's the key. I got a great Pocahontas story, which I'm going to tell you very briefly. But yeah, I love the. Could you stand up for me for a moment? Because you're still wearing your hair like Pocahontas.
Yeah.
Could you? I want you to. Are you an animator? So could you stand up? I'm going to ask you to do something. I'm not meaning to embarrass you, but your hair is beautiful and it's so long. Could you? Can you do that for me? I want you to do this. Go on. No, go on. Just I want your hair to move. Okay. Yeah, perfect. All right. Thank you. Because this is... Okay. So
Actually, when I was younger, I remembered myself to dream every night Pocahontas.
Yes!
And then after two years, I mean, I was Mulan in my dreams.
You see, isn't it great like how the effect of these movies can... I mean, you know, the story of Pocahontas Pocahontas is a very real character, and it's the story, really, of the people coming from the UK to make a new life in America. And Pocahontas, at the beginning of the movie... she has this beautiful, long, flowing hair. And we had made Lion King, and we're at the top of our game, right? We are making money. Our movies are costing more and more, but we're becoming really successful. And so we had, with Pocahontas, she has this beautiful, long hair. Well, this is a hand-drawn movie. So we wanted her to have long, beautiful hair that moved. And what you did for me in doing that movement, which was so helpful, was that your hair moving was actually secondary movement, right? For you 2D animation students, if you're out there, you know, I'm moving like this, but if I do something, you've got a secondary action. We decided that we would have a separate team doing the hair. So we had the body animation, which was done by Glenn Keane, the great Glenn Keane. And then we had a hair unit who'd do the hair. Well, somebody figured out that the movie was due to be open in July, and somebody, one of the production guys who's doing all the scheduling and budgeting and everything, suddenly said, well, the body will be finished in March, which is what it needed to be finished with, but unfortunately the hair won't be finished till July. That's after the movie opens. So we sent Pocahontas to the hairdressers. If you look at the movie, there are scenes in the movie where our hair is tied back. So I tell this fictitious, this is a completely fictitious story, which is that we wanted to see Pocahontas at the beginning of the movie with this long flowing hair. She doesn't have a care in the world. She's the colors of the wind. Her hair's flowing. And then she meets John Smith, who's one of the people coming with the settlers, and she befriends John Smith, but the problem starts to happen. Her own people feeling she's betrayed them, and the settlers are very suspicious of her. So we wanted to show this emotionally, so we tied her hair back. Well, of course, that's complete bullshit in terms of why we did it, but actually, from a storytelling perspective, it's exactly right. What a wonderful way to show a character that is conflicted, then conflict them, tie their hair back, constrain them. And so she gets constrained. So anyway, your Pocahontas story reminded me of that. I'm sorry. But yeah, so it's a lesson to us all of us producers. It's just because you have all the money in the world doesn't mean to say you should just do anything you can do. Make it work. It made absolute sense tying her hair back because in the middle of the movie, she's completely constrained. Nobody likes her. She's lost. Another question, perhaps a last one, I don't know. Somebody right at the back, yes, sir. No, I'm going.
Thank you for sharing your experience and your insight this morning. My question is that it's in regards to the art of pitching. Knowing the rules and grasping the rules to the game doesn't actually make you a good athlete. On that note, could you use one of your recent projects, or if not, your past projects, and give us an example of your elevator pitch?
Well, I think that's a very interesting concept, which I want to touch on the first part of it. Just because you understand the rules of being a great athlete doesn't make you a great athlete. That is true. I mean, not everyone's going to be a great filmmaker. The reason we can mention some great filmmakers is because they are exceptional. So they not only understand the rules, but they know how to use them and how to tell them. Yeah, I don't want to pitch you something because I think I've talked about pitching. I'd rather take other questions. But yeah, are you pitching concisely? I mean, if I was doing a class with you, yeah, I'd absolutely pitch you an idea. I'd much rather coach you on something. But it's getting down to the fundamentals of what the idea is. And not getting lost in everything else. What is the core idea? And I've talked about the core idea of Nemo and these thoughts. So let me take another question. Gentleman straight at the back who's standing up. I thought, yeah, right.
I was just wondering at the moment where in series we treat all subjects why in American animation movies we don't have films like Grave of the Fireflies? I mean, in the tone, or the subject, or the way to...
Well, I think there's a real... where are you from?
France.
Okay, so I think, you know, let's take France, for example, because they have the greatest... I mean, I've worked in France quite... I've done a couple of movies there, and I also set up Disney Studios in France. And, of course, I'm British, so, you know, I was going to France when I was a very young man. There's a problem with subsidy in France. Oh, no, France is unfair. In Europe... The quality of animation in France, in Europe is wonderful and still making 2D movies. There's a problem with the use of subsidy in Europe. I have no subsidy in America and regret it because I do think there's a challenge about not having it. The challenge with subsidy is that if I tell you that I'm going to make an art house movie with your subsidy, where have I set the bar? I set it here. If I tell you I'm going to make a commercial movie, I just set the bar here. And what the attitude is, or can be, is that anyone can make a commercial movie. That is a mistake. If you make a commercial movie, you could spend the rest of your career making whatever movies you want to make, because everyone will give you money. So there's a tendency both on the subsidy side of it and the people pitching in Europe to use America as a reason for not doing something. Oh, we don't want to be like them, and we need subsidy. And I think you need to be very careful what is subsidy? Subsidy is the people's money, and it's patronizing and condescending to just make films that are not for your audience. Because many people make films, this is quite controversial, I know I'm being quite controversial here. Many people make films for their peers, and they forget, in my slides, who's your film for? It's not for your peers. It's for your audience. And don't ever lose sight of that. And why wouldn't you want millions of people to see your film? Or are you so superior that because people buy a ticket for your film that their intelligence is less? This is not about not challenging them, but it's so easy to leap to that place. And I've made a terrible generalization. And I know many great European filmmakers. You know, and I'm a huge fan of, you know, Song of the Sea and films like which I think are beautifully done, Long Way North. So I do know my, you know, I know some of these films, and I long for them to be more successful. And sometimes you could argue that they're not successful, they don't get marketed properly, they don't get, promoted correctly. But I longed, and I saw a fabulous film in Belgium a few years ago called Magic House, which I really like. I think the character designs in Magic House are stunning. I love the story, but it wasn't very successful, funnily enough, because, in fact, it was a film, I was on the jury of the Stuttgart Film Festival, and the jury was split. It was my favorite film, but we ended up going for everyone's number two choice because we couldn't agree. But it's actually a very, 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 very good film. But somehow it was disrespected in Europe because it was commercial, and I thought that was a great shame. I think we need to use subsidy to yes, we do need to give money to people to make films, but those filmmakers have a responsibility. And don't let's in our own minds believe that if a film is commercially successful, that somehow it's a lesser film. I think that's a very dangerous place to go to. But I do appreciate that in America we can make films that, you know, can feel somewhat the same. And I can't tell you how many marketing and meetings I've sat in when people tell me something won't work for some really idiotic reason. So I'm I'm truly conflicted on that because I am. You know, my cultural roots are British, and my working career in animation is American. So I'm in an interesting. But anyway, it's going to happen. But look at, you know, there's a fabulous film entered here from Noman, in the animation thing. There are many very good films, but you know, the animation schools in France, the animation talent in France is stunning. And some of the greatest short films. So I just want to see one of those films really soar and filmmakers not talk themselves out of something that might be commercial because somehow they think they will be told that they're selling their creative soul to the devil. Don't go there. Don't ever go there. Eva's left me. She's given up on me. Yes, sir. right at the back. I've got questions flying in from the back. So do you think it's the last one? Oh, it's 20 past 12.
So you say, okay.
I'm allowed to do one more.
One
and then
more.
You know the hook, avoid the hook. And you know what I said earlier about being committed and being concise? I'm terrible about being concise. So yes, sir.
Yeah. Hello, Mr. Howard. Thank you for sharing all those industry information and knowledge for us. And now I want to hear something personal. And I want to ask you if there is any film, if there is any one particular film that you don't want us to watch.
Oh, I don't want to.
I want to specify this question. I'm talking about film that.
Are you talking about personal films that may have been filmed?
I'm talking about film that the creator is so wisely that he contained every essential elementary in this film that you don't want us to see, because when we see it, we might want to, we might just rob your job in the future.
I don't think any of us should ever be scared of that. Or not me personally, but any of us. And as I touched on earlier, bad films or films that don't work, you can learn so much from, because you can ask yourself why. And you can probably find those beats in the film where it didn't work for you, where you got lost, where you started on the, you know, the phone got fired up and you started texting. It's also just on that note, the inciting incident and grabbing an audience, that moment has come much earlier than it used to have done in films because of our attention span. So as a filmmaker, you've got to grab that audience, you know, because we know people do text, and you know your phone goes off and somebody says, hey, what are you doing? And you go, oh, I'm in the movies. And then they text back and say, what are you watching? And you go, you give them the name of the film. They go, so? And they go, oh, I don't like it. And you're only 3 minutes into the film, you know. So as a filmmaker, you've got to be very careful about grabbing that audience, because we can be diverted. When the movie lights go down in a theater, I'm not in control of you anymore. There's somebody else nagging at you. It's your phone. And if I don't grab you, but I don't think there's anything I would say don't do, don't watch. Watch everything. There are films that I think I've worked on have been marvelous. There's films I've worked on that I think have been amazingly enjoyable to work on, but weren't commercially successful. Didn't work as movies. So, and some of the more challenging ones, certainly 6 months before the end of Lion King, it was the worst movie anyone had worked on. Nobody wanted to work on Lion King. They hated it. Didn't work as a movie. Didn't have a proper act two. Act three was too short. And then certain things happened and the movie suddenly worked, but it was a very difficult movie. Everyone wanted to work on Pocahontas, funnily enough. They didn't want to work on Lion King. They wanted to work on Pocahontas. Those two movies were made at the same time. I'm going to stop now. I thank you very nicely to allow me to go on until way after 12 o'clock or way after when I was supposed to finish. So thank you all so much. And thank you for your questions. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you.